William Morrow and Harper Audio present The Women's History of the Modern World, How Radicals, Rebels, and Every Woman Revolutionized the Last 200 Years, by Rosalind Miles, read by Erin Bennett. A note before we begin. Don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider or go directly to www.harpercollins.com/audio/Women's History Modern World. The enhancement contains a list of titles for additional reading. Preface. Who was the all-time top goal scorer in the Football World Cup? None other than the aptly named Quicksilver forward of the Brazilian women's team, Marta Vieira da Silva, who is changing history and making it anew. When I was a girl, we never played football and never thought we could. It was only one of the many ways that horizons were narrowing for girls at the same time as they were expanding for boys, a situation that was not expected to change. As a child, I cannot remember when I realized that to most people, girls were less important than boys. Expecting a baby, I discovered that all pregnant women were called mother by the medical staff. Leaving college and trying to get a job, I was routinely asked, "You've got a wonderful husband and two lovely children. What are you compensating for?" Events like these are less likely to happen now that women have begun rebelling against their long-established role as adjuncts to the lives of men and children, and have emerged as strong and significant in their own right. This striking and exhilarating change has been the work of the women we celebrate in this book, even as we share the rewards of their determination and pluck. Rebel women have spent the last 200 years thinking the unthinkable, dreaming of change, and making it come true. A female premier? A female president? A female pope? Why not? It has been a thrilling task to track the stories of these extraordinary women who were no longer voices singing in the wilderness like the change makers of former times, but have banded together to remake our world. The freedom they have won for women has been in an unofficial alliance with other groups, including good men, when liberating girls from the narrow demands of compulsory wife and motherhood has allowed boys, too, to choose a different path. The women's movement has grown up and come of age in the same era as the wider LGBTQ+ community, Black Lives Matter, anti-racist protests, and calls for diversity, all creating a more inclusive and a better society for us all. Such a wide canvas had to be selective, and I had to leave out so many of my own heroines that I can only apologize if I have omitted yours. I aimed to achieve a balance between those who are household names and the many women who are less well known, in the hope of encouraging readers to follow their trail, and that of all the others who have been lost to us and gone unnoticed by the history books. I accept that readers may find this account concentrates heavily on the Western world, which is my area of study, but I do not present it as definitive. On the contrary, I hope it will galvanize as many as possible to recount their own version of events. We need history from all perspectives. Liberating women is a work in progress. I want this to be a story that inspires others to take the history of women further and higher in our emergence from centuries in the shadows to the broad light of day. Some readers may feel that this is not real history because, like my previous Women's History of the World, published in America as Who Cooked the Last Supper, it makes no pretense to the traditional historical fiction of impartiality. Others might feel that it is unfair to men. I can only make the same defense that I made then, echoing the pioneer women's historian Mary Ritter Beard, who faced the same charges and made this robust response. There is sure to be an overemphasis in places, but my apology is that when conditions have been long weighted too much on one side, it is necessary to bear down heavily on the other. In the 21st century, we are looking forward to a world that offers a myriad of opportunities to follow in the footsteps of my rebel women. These are the lamplighters who have gone before to show us the way, and we must not let them down. Let us not rest till all of us are free. The world's future must be better than its past. Rosalind Miles. 1. Turning the Wheel. As I sat watching every man at the charter house, I said to myself, why not every woman? George Bernard Shaw. Chapter 1. Rights. For women? Bliss was it in that dawn to be alive. William Wordsworth. So you think revolutions can be made with rosewater? Sebastian Roch Nicolas du Chamfort. The position of women in the civil rights movement is prone. Stokely Carmichael. Prone, said the man. Was she face down that day, or face up? Staring into the basket of blood-soaked severed heads, where her own would shortly drop, or strapped to the board on her back, looking up at the blade as it fell? It was the French Revolution, the dawning of the modern age. For women, it promised the best and swiftly delivered the worst. This 45-year-old met her death with her thick black hair hacked off in clumps to bare her neck for the blade, the common treatment for condemned women, including the queen, Marie Antoinette. When so many were killed that the cobbles of Paris were sticky with their blood, most women died unknown and unnamed. But this guillotine on this dank day of November 3rd, 1793, sliced through the neck and silenced the brain of one of the most original thinkers of the time, Olympe de Gouges. Her last moments were recorded by an anonymous Parisian. Yesterday, at 7 o'clock in the evening, a most extraordinary person called Olympe de Gouges, who held the imposing title of Woman of Letters, was taken to the scaffold. She approached the scaffold with a calm and serene expression on her face and forced the guillotine's furies, which had driven her to this place of torture, to admit that such courage and beauty had never been seen before. That woman had thrown herself in the revolution, body and soul. But having quickly perceived how atrocious the system adopted by the Jacobins was, she chose to retrace her steps. She attempted to unmask the villains through the literary productions which she had printed and put up. They never forgave her, and she paid for her carelessness with her head. The reason for the death of de Gouges lay in the slogan that set out the aims of the revolution, Liberté, Égalité, Fraternité. Under this banner, the revolutionaries rising up against the monarchy paraded their wares, promising citizenship, comradeship, and freedom from tyranny, all three on offer for the first time in French history. But any hopes the women of France might have entertained of liberty or equality were soon crushed. One by one, they had to face the reality every revolution delivers sooner or later, that when freedom is given out, women are not in the queue. Both liberty and equality are restricted to and controlled by the universal fraternity of men. From sea to shining sea. That hard truth had been forced down the throats of the women of America only 14 years earlier, when the War of Independence broke out in 1775. This 8-year conflict, a crucial forerunner to the French Revolution, saw many rebel women fighting on the front line alongside men. They died like men too, either in battle or from combat diseases like typhoid fever or infected wounds. The she-soldier Deborah Sampson who enlisted in the 4th Massachusetts Regiment at the age of 21, showed the courage that made the nation when she dug out a musket ball lodged in her groin with her penknife and sewed up the wound afterward, all without benefit of anesthesia. A few of these female patriots fought as women, usually if they had a husband or brother at their side, but most found it expedient to disguise themselves as men, whatever the risk of discovery. In the ranks, Samson, who adopted the alias of Robert Shurtleff, was teased for her lack of facial hair and nicknamed Molly, a slang term for a gay or effeminate male. Undeterred, she proved her worth not only in battle, but as the leader of dangerous reconnaissance expeditions, scouting targets for attack so important that they were chosen by the commander-in-chief of the army, George Washington himself. She was only discovered during an epidemic of camp fever, when she was too ill to resist the army doctor's examination, but her valor was recognized. Honorably discharged in October 1783, Samson married, had 3 children, and later became the only woman soldier of the Continental Army to be granted a full military pension. Another world first was achieved by her widowed husband when he petitioned for spousal rights to Samson's pension after her death in 1867, and won. In the American Civil War of 1861 to 1865, an Illinois-born mother of 3, Frances Clallan Clayton, was one of a number of women who signed up for active service disguised as men. Enlisting as Jack Williams, she joined the Union Army with her husband and fought side by side with him until he was killed, then reportedly stepped over his body to continue fighting. Like Deborah Sampson, Clayton lived to see her war service recognized and to be honored as a veteran. Were these the first steps toward equality? Shoulder to shoulder, bolder and bolder, women fighting side by side with men, yes. But women's rights as a political aim? Hell no. Revolutions only succeed because they win women's support by offering the promise of inclusion into the brave new world where men and women make common cause and go forward together. Yet, however sincerely intended, this promise vanishes when women actively engage in the struggle. During the Revolution, American women discovered what the French women were shortly to learn, that whatever their courage and endurance, they were all working for men, in a system run by men, for the cause of men. To question the cause was to betray it, so they were never able to single out their own interests as women, and to fight for that cause and that alone. Look no further than the closing lines of America the Beautiful, the patriotic ode to manhood of 1893, written by the writer, professor, and activist Catherine Lee Bates for proof. America, America, God shed his grace on thee, and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. Yes, brotherhood, or fraternité, as the French had it. It's that happy lad frater familias, every girl's brother playing junior to good old pater familias in the family hierarchy, in training for the top job from birth. Who could deny that young junior's god, brotherhood, had to be protected in order to ensure his succession? Revolution, the great engine. The American Revolution ended the King of England's rule and founded the American Republic on September 3, 1783, with the Treaty of Paris. Where one revolution ended, another began. Less than 6 years later, also in Paris, the people of France embarked on their own struggle to overthrow their monarchy and set up a republic. For French women, the omens were good. The American Revolution had been a male military campaign in which the women who participated largely passed as men and served under male command. By direct contrast, the women of France began and led the spontaneous uprising that sparked the French Revolution. And throughout the struggle, women equaled or even outdid the men. They had every reason to believe that the freedom they were fighting for would be theirs on equal terms with men. And for a brief shining moment, the women of Paris were indeed a vital part of that new dawn, if not the dawn itself. That occurred when a raging mob stormed the Bastille on July 14, 1789, a date now recognized as the start of hostilities between the monarchy and the sans-culottes, persons too poor to have pants. In the heroic story that ran around the world, a woman dressed as an Amazon led the attack on the Bastille, the most dreaded symbol of the king's power. According to the pamphlets pumped out by the royalist press, this rebel commander was a 26-year-old Belgian, Theron Duméricourt. Tall, strong-featured, wild-haired, and with more than a hint of a squint, Duméricourt cut a striking figure as she plunged into the life of revolutionary Paris, striding around town in a man's riding clothes and sporting a large hat with a flamboyantly phallic plume.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.